WRFG Atlanta, 89.3 FM, your station for progressive information. WRFG provides a voice for those who have been traditionally denied access to broadcast media through the involvement of a broad base of community elements to guarantee that access. In the utilization of the Foundation's facilities and in its programs, the following communities will receive first priority: those who continue to be denied free and open access to the broadcast media, and those who suffer oppression or exploitation based upon class, race, sex, age, creed, disability, sexual orientation, or immigrant status.
Before you put on this record, understand, this is for all of my ancestors who were raped, were killed, and hung because of their fight for freedom and for dignity. They died for me, and they died for you. This is for them to know that, yes, even today, we are still fired up, and we're still talking about revolution.
This program was produced in 2016 on Just Peace on WRFG Atlanta 89.3 FM. The producer was me, Heather Gray, and I interviewed Rashid Nuri, who is the leading urban organic farmer here in the city of Atlanta. I always say the Southeast and throughout the country as well. He talked primarily about George Washington Carver, the work of this great man and the influence and impact he had, certainly in agriculture, but in so many other ways. We also had people calling in 2016, and we have their comments on this recording. Unfortunately, we can't accept calls from people under the circumstances, given the COVID-19 situation. I'm hoping that soon we'll be able to get back to normal broadcasting and be able to have calls from people. My name is Heather Gray, and the program is Just Peace, and I want to welcome you all to our discussion this evening. And I'm pleased to say we're going to be talking with Rashid Nuri, which is always a treat to talk with Rashid and find out what's happening in agriculture in Atlanta, getting an update. However, I want you to know that the opinions expressed on Just Peace do not necessarily reflect those of Radio Free Georgia Broadcasting Foundation Incorporated, staff or volunteers, and portions of the program are pre-recorded. Rashid, it's a treat to have you yet again here in the WRFG studio.
Thank you, Heather. I sometimes wonder, is that announcement personal or do you do that often? Because every time I'm here, you tell them folks out there in the listening audience, be careful, because what he may say does not reflect what you think.
Exactly. Yeah. All right. But I do that with every single guest, and every public affairs producer does the same, Rashid.
Oh, okay. So I shouldn't feel so bad.
It's not particular to you.
Very good. Good evening, everybody. It's a pleasure to be here with you, Heather. I appreciate this opportunity to talk to folk about the work that we do and whatever other issues may come up over the course of the evening.
I just want to tell our listeners that I'm going to dialogue with Rashid. We're going to dialogue together here for a little while about agriculture. And I think we're going to focus this evening on George Washington Carver. We've talked about him before, but it's always worth going back to the great George Washington Carver. Now, Rashid, you are engaged in agriculture, and of course, one of the mentors, I think, whether you knew him or not, or this is true for most people I know in agriculture, but particularly you, I think, is George Washington Carver. And, you know, we've talked about him quite a bit, but when were you first aware of him?
Oh, I was very young. Talking to our engineer this evening, much of my life I read biographies and histories is what I was interested in. And I can remember there was a series of hard-covered books that had biographies of everybody, and George Washington Carver was one of those.
So what was the book?
History of George Washington Carver.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
And this was, you know, 60 years ago.
Yeah.
So I've been aware of him for much of my life. The awareness has increased over the years. I've gone through different phases of my own learning and education in the world of agriculture. George Washington Carver he's more than an icon. It's a very multidimensional man. The levels of contribution that he has made to not only America but to the world are just absolutely amazing. And we continue to build upon the legacy that he established so many years ago.
Okay, so amazing in what sort of way?
Well,
Let's talk about who he is first, again.
George Washington Carver is he's a shaman, very spiritual man. He was a plant scientist, trained in Iowa, and Booker T. Washington brought him to Tuskegee at the end of the 19th century, and he was at Tuskegee until I think he died in January of 1943.
That's correct.
And his impact on American agriculture, American industry, social relations, all of these things were absolutely amazing. He single-handedly saved the South. A lot of folks think of him as only having worked with black people because he was at Tuskegee, but the impact of his contribution literally saved Southern agriculture. And Southern agriculture was built around cotton. He helped, and cotton at the time that he started doing his work at Tuskegee. It had just about played out. The boll weevil was eating it all up, and they didn't know what to do. And he came up with a solution, which was crop rotation. Very simple stuff that we know now and certainly implement in our natural urban agricultural work. Some of the big farmers don't do it very much, but to an extent they all do. I mean, that's the standard catechism of agriculture is rotate your crops. And he's the one that introduced it. He introduced soybeans, he introduced sweet potatoes, and he introduced peanuts into the rotation with cotton, and that brought the soil back and saved the South. If they hadn't done that, they were mining those soils by planting the same thing over and over and over again, and the plants were weak because the soil had been mined, and that's why the boll weevils got in there and spread. Still scared of boll weevils around. They don't want to see it come back. But Carver showed them how to do that, how to take care of it.
And again, I think that was largely because when the crops were rotated, it fixed nitrogen in the soil. I know we've talked about this a bit.
Well, no, right? It did more than just fix nitrogen.
What else did it do?
Added organic material to the soil. Okay, I mean, it brought nutrients back into the soil by having the crop rotation, so that those plants, you know, the relationship that we have with plants is just amazing. The complexity, yet the simplicity. You know, everything on the planet is dependent upon the sun. But we can't live on the sun directly. Energies from the sun is accumulated through our plants, and then we eat those plants and animals, and that's where we get our sun. But the symbiosis that exists between the sun, the earth, the water, all of these coming together is what makes it work. So yeah, you know, add it, fixed nitrogen back in the soil, but you can add nitrogen. It's all the other elements that come into play. The organic material that you need to put in the soil to make sure the soil is alive. If you're just putting chemicals in there, you're going to kill it. You're going to kill it, the soil. So therefore, you need to have life-giving elements added to the soil, and Carver showed them how to do that.
You know, Rashid, I was reading some about Carver today and read something that I hadn't before about his work. And with the crop rotations, it so energized the soil and production for farmers in Alabama that there was just a huge amount, an excess amount of peanuts and sweet potatoes, to the point that they couldn't sell all of the crops they were producing. So Carver started looking at other ways to use these crops.
He looked at ways that he the crops and their byproducts can be utilized. He gets credit for inventing peanut butter. He really didn't. But there were hundreds of other things that he did that using these products and plastics and paints and so many different ways. Carver introduced, he had a wagon which he would ride around in and go out to see the farmers. So in a lot of ways, he was an extension agent, and he's a hero. He really is an amazing man. Amazing man. And the sacrifices he made personally in order to be able to do this work, most people don't know, and are absolutely shocked to find out. Okay, and first and foremost was that he was a eunuch. He was castrated, and that's the reason they allowed him to go to school with white people in Iowa, because he was not a threat. You know, Carver was born a slave, and he was educated. And the only reason he could be educated if they castrated him, which is something that was not uncommon back at that time, but it certainly isn't. The depravity of that is not discussed, because it would place a lot of guilt. Here's a man, a great man, and this is the sacrifice that he made for his career, for his people, for the world, to give up his manhood. And what's amazing, if you can go research, there are only four instances where his voice was recorded. And he had a little tiny itty bitty voice. Many years ago, I was in Los Angeles doing urban agriculture there. And the man was right. I wish I could remember his name. We did a George Washington Carver celebration over at USC, University of Southern California. And part of that, we had him come down from, he lived in Marin County, and he came down to, he was our keynote speaker. And this man was writing, I haven't seen the book yet, but he may still be working on it, which in my opinion would have probably been the most comprehensive biography that had been done, because he made a point of going around and speaking to every person who was alive that had a connection with George Washington Carver. So that's an immense responsibility and task. And we were riding down Slauson Avenue, and I told him, are you going to put in the book the fact that he was castrated? He said he didn't know. And my opinion to him still is that you need to, because if you're going to write a tome as well documented as what you're telling me you're going to do, and do not include it, if your book is the most referenced there is and you leave that out, it's going to go down as the history, and it's going to exclude an important factor, things that people ought to know about this man. And I hope I put enough guilt on him that he put it in there. That's something to consider.
Project South and the Hunger Coalition of Atlanta, in partnership with Community Organized Relief Effort, have launched free COVID-19 testing at 9 Gammon Street, Southeast Atlanta. Drive-through and walk-up testing options are available Monday through Friday from 10 a.m. to 4 p.m. The tests are self-administered via throat swab, and individuals will be contacted within 4 to 7 days with results. If you need COVID-19 testing, 404-622-0602. If you need testing for the coronavirus, this is your opportunity. Once again, that's 404-622-0602. Project South and the Hunger Coalition of Atlanta, in partnership with Community Organized Relief Effort, have launched COVID-19 testing at 9 Gammon Street, Southeast Atlanta. Corresponse.org/COVID-19-Atlanta.
Another public service announcement by your listener-sponsored and supported community radio, 89.3 FM, WRFG.org.
All right, again, I just want you all to know we're talking with Rashid Nuri. I just always so enjoy talking about George Washington Carver. Here's a quote, and I think you use this quote or part of this quote a lot, Rashid. It's a quote from Carver. He said, "It is not the style of clothes one wears, neither the kind of automobile one drives, nor the amount of money one has in the bank that counts. These mean nothing. It is simply service that measures success." George Washington Carver.
No, it's more than quoted sometimes. If you get an email from me, that last line is on every email that I sent out. And I firmly believe that it's simply service that measures success. I so believe that. Most people who know me know that when you leave me, I'm going to tell you, let me know if there's anything I can do to help. Okay, because I think that is being of service, being in service, is what you're supposed to do.
You know, I want to ask you also, we've had somewhat of a discussion about this, but not very much, about the spiritual connection that George Washington Carver had with plants. And I want to read this quote from something I was reading today about him. It says, "The degree of Carver's impact extends beyond his agricultural contributions, encompassing his service to help others obtain a higher quality of life. Carver contributed to the economic improvement of the Southern farmer by offering alternative crops beneficial to them and their land. Though Carver prides his success on service, his environmental contributions were substantial. He conscientiously utilized bio-based products and industrial products made from renewable resources rather than those made from scarce or non-renewable resources. Environmentally, his contributions were viewed by some as an agricultural revolution. He was an extraordinary man who recognized the natural relationships of living things, both plants and human, or plants and people. He was a deeply religious man who treasured the world of nature and saw himself as a vehicle by which the secrets of nature could be understood and harnessed for the good of mankind. That was his mission in life. And his reward for performing this mission was the simple knowledge that he was performing well God's will."
Amen.
Right. So, but it said, Rashid, and this article doesn't go into this, but it said that he talked with plants.
You've never had that experience?
I haven't. My sister has.
You know, what we live in a world they're so reductionist, and we don't understand the whole. Organic to me means whole, complete. And we're not as people, human beings on the earth today, we are disconnected from the soil. We are disconnected from the natural world. We feel that we are superior to the natural world, and thus attempt to conquer nature instead of being in harmony and in tune with nature. The plants and the animals, all of them form a community that existed long before we got here and will be here long after we're gone. All those folks who say that they're concerned about climate change and how we're going to destroy the earth, I am not worried about that at all. Really not. Because the planet has been here and it's been strong for gazillions of years. Mankind's only been here for 15 minutes. And the real problem is if we don't take care of the environment around it, it may kill us. It's the human beings that are going to have a problem, not Mother Earth. Mother Earth has been here and it's going to be able to continue. So that and I'm going to get back to Carver talking to the plants. So if we understand the relationships between the plants and the earth and the sun and the water, we would have much more a greater respect for what's around us and our connections and interactions with it. Yeah, Carver talked to the plants. No, the plants talked to Carver. If you get out there, he would get up in the morning and go out and walk, take his walk in the fields and listen. You know, we do that in the garden. If you go there and the plants will tell you what they need, when they need it. And all you have to do is pay attention. Open your eyes. Open all of your being to be able to receive the information that's coming in. The plants have a way of communicating with each other. This is why natural urban agriculture works. You know, we don't have to worry about the pesticides and the chemicals on there because but those plants will take care of themselves. If some kind of disease gets in there through the mycorrhizae, the fungi that's under the soil, that soil web, they're able to communicate and say, whoa, something's coming to get us. Let's gird up. Yeah? So they get ready and protect themselves. So they may have to sacrifice. That's what happens in any war. Okay, you're gonna have some casualties. But what you have to do is protect the community, and the plants are able to do that. You get out into the woods, man, you have different kinds of tree, hardwoods and the evergreens that are there. On one part of the year, they switch back and forth feeding each other. And they do. They literally talk. The communication in the field, in the garden, comes up. The most important part of the garden is around the edges, okay? Because you may turn that soil over in the middle. And that's why you want to minimize how much you turn in that soil. You certainly don't want to go in there with big tillers. That's like putting everything into a blender, and you're breaking up all the life that's there. But they communicate. So if you look at our garden, we have semi-permanent beds. They're only 4 feet wide, all right? So that the mycorrhiza, that's all them little white fine funguses that are in there, they can communicate with each other. If I got a big huge field that I've been spinning over and understanding how the life starts around the edges, the wider that field is, the harder it's going to be for those things to communicate. That's why you go out and look at these big chemical farms, these commercial farms. There's no, this soil is a dead. You can't find an earthworm, a mealy bug, roly-poly, a centipede. Nothing is in that soil that's going to bring life to it. So that's why it becomes a chemistry set. You add the chemicals to make those plants grow. You add the nitrogen in it. We owe that science, that reduction of science, to a man named Dr. Leopold von Liebig. I just think that's a hell of a name. Leopold von Liebig, who back in the 1850s discovered a couple of things. He's the man that came up with vitamins, vital amino acids. He broke that down, and he was able to isolate what are the principal elements. They called it the law of the minimum. What are the minimal things that you need in order to make the plants grow? And by that discovery enabling to come up with the whole concept of N, P, and K, nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium, to add back to the soil and make things grow, appear to grow. But what comes out of this is that steroid plastic food that there's so many of, that's what you see in the grocery stores that have no taste. You want to add hybridization to that, GMOs, and you end up with food that is worthless. It's really rough.
Not necessarily good for us either.
My opinion, and I think the science is will bear this out even more in the future, is that the human body has not evolved to the place where it can metabolize these denatured foods.
Right.
And that's the problem.
Right.
Yeah, so back to Carver. They bring it on back around. So yeah, Carver, what he would listen to those plants. They would tell him what experiments to do, what would work, because he was a spiritual. He opened himself. He allowed himself to commune with nature. And you use that language of communing with nature. You're actually communing with nature means you're communing with God. Being with those plants, it's a meditative form. Can take you into a whole nother realm if you let yourself go and try to establish that connection that you have with the soil.
You had asked me, so I hadn't talked with plants. So what is your experience in sort of communing with plants, Rashid?
Everything I'm just telling you.
Can you possibly? So you can't expound upon that any further.
What do you want? I can tell you when I ran the rose garden, we had 30,000 rose bushes, and I saw the rose elves out there. Okay, every morning I get up around sunrise, go out, cut roses, man. And the little people out there running around in the rose garden.
Right.
I mean, so I don't know how deep you want to get into this. Whatever the energy is, the intelligence that has created this sphere in which we live, God, Allah, Prana, Chi, Ki, that energy that permeates throughout Gaia, Mother Earth, is. And I think it's up to us to tune into it, all right, and try to be into it. I mean, the creation is magnificent. Look at the intelligence. You ever looked at the pictures from the Hubble telescope to see all those galaxies out there made up of millions of stars, and that they're millions of light years away in a universe that, I don't know if it's expanding now or contracting, whichever way it's going. It's huge. There's so much out there. And for those who have a solipsist orientation to think the whole world revolves around planet Earth are fools, in my opinion. There's so much more out there that you need, that we should be aware of and try to find our connection to it. And it comes down back to where each of us stands and how we conduct ourselves in relationship to all of this creation that is around us. You can't miss it.
I was talking about my sister talking with plants. So my sister's name is Grace, and she is just full of grace. But in any case, she has told me that there have been times that she's talked with plants, and she's seen the leaves move.
Oh, yeah. No, there's so many. See, we look at a plant, we look at vegetation, and we think, oh, them things are just sitting there. They ain't doing nothing. But if you were to, you know, if you put it on slow motion cameras and speed up and watch and see how they move, how they react. I mean, Michael Pollan wrote a wonderful article on it, The Intelligence of Plants, that was in the New Yorker magazine last year. I keep a copy on my desk and send it out to whoever is interested in. But, you know, how we move around, you know that character, the Flash, that comic book character, Flash is zooming around. You can hardly see him move. Well, that's how we are to the plants. Humans are zooming around. The plants are sitting there, but the plants are very much alive and conscious. Okay, plants, the secret life of plants, several books that have been written around that subject. You cut them, they feel pain. Okay, I mean, I can't say pain. You can see them react when they've been cut. They react to the emotional. They have emotional. Our emotional responses affect the plants that are around us. The plants also affect us. The aromas, most of the fragrance, all the fragrances that we use in aromatherapy come from plants. Right? And look at the effect that they have on us in the concentrations that they use. So yes. You can see that if you take the time to look at it and study, you will see the plants react.
You know, I want to mention something about this. There is a farmer I heard of in Saskatchewan in Canada, right? So his crop would have been huge. I mean, probably a monocrop production, probably wheat or oats, something like that. But what he found was, in order to enhance the production of his crop, he would get these loudspeakers that he would put around the field, and he would play Beethoven or Bach or something. And apparently it had a profound effect on these plants. Does that make sense to you, Rashid?
Oh, absolutely.
Does it really?
Music,
yeah.
Music is the healing force of the universe, okay? Of the entire of the universe. You go anywhere you go in the creation, you're going to hear music. You're going to hear sounds, okay? And you get the right vibration. And if you also understand from physics, everything has a vibration. So if you play music that has the same frequencies as those plants, they're going to be affected.
How do you know the frequencies of the plants? How would you know that?
intuitive. Intuition. Right. You gotta find, I mean, there's certain kinds of music. I mean, here's a better way to look at it. Yeah, this is what I'm saying. This is how we get reductionist. When you like music.
I do.
Isn't there some music that you find soothing?
Yes.
And helps you spur
yes.
your creativity?
Yes, yes.
Right? Calms you, relaxes you. And there's other music that excites you. All right? And then there's some dissonance out there that'll just drive you crazy, you hear. I mean, it's all the same. See, part of the problem is we try to separate ourselves from the plants and animals and see ourselves as so much different from them, when in fact they have a higher senses than we do.
Yeah, interesting.
I think so. That's my opinion.
All right. So I want everyone to know you are listening to WRFG Atlanta 89.3 FM. My name is Heather Gray, and the program is Just Peace. I'm honored, as always, to be talking with Rashid Nuri. We've been talking a bit about George Washington Carver, but also about the spiritual relationship with plants and of plants. So it's very interesting. I mean, I think that you were talking about the reductionist. When you're talking about the reductionist mentality toward plants, would you define that? How do you define that? What do you mean by that exactly? Is that going to be a challenge?
No. No, I understand it. You know, I talked about von Liebig when he could reduce the plant needs down to nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium. That's reductionist, okay? And it's isolating certain elements of it, and it's just not correct. When they started using ammonium phosphate and nitrate, out in the fields as fertilizer, that's reductionist. That was gunpowder that they're using. So the war manufacturers say, well, we made good money during the war. Now what can we do to keep our plants running? And they put that gunpowder out into the fields to grow food.
Wow.
I mean, that's reductionist.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, exactly. All right. Okay.
I could go on and on.
All right.
Let me say, the leaves are falling off the trees. And don't y'all take them leaves and put them in bags so that the trash man can get it. Collect those leaves, put them in your backyard, and compost them so you can put them back into the soil to grow your food next spring.
Exactly, yeah. Exactly. And Truly Living Well, you have quite a bit of compost there, don't you?
Yes, ma'am. So I'm so happy these leaves are falling down. That gives us material.
All right, wonderful.
And when you're working on a farm, you always want to have material, water and material you got to have around if you're going to grow food the way we do.
All right. Caller, thank you so much for joining us. You have a question or comment you'd like to make?
Yeah, I wanted to comment about George Washington Carver and the American government, as well as the world, they owe a lot to that man. He's sort of like what you might call a, even though he was a chemist, he was like an avatar type of a person. Like a, those avatars, they're born like once every hundreds of years or something like that, because he was able to, the things he was able to do with the plants. Let's see, one of the things that another thing he was able to do was, I believe, Henry Ford. He didn't too much care about black people, but he befriended George Washington Carver because he knew the genius of the man. And I think George Washington Carver had told him, the automobiles were already being made before Henry Ford. It was a black American, I think his name was Patterson. He was already making cars, and because cars were handmade. But when Henry Ford met with George Washington Carver, He gave him some knowledge about soybeans and about how to mass produce cars.
Yeah, he used that. They were for the paint. Soy oil, the soybeans were used to make the paint, the lacquer that went onto those model was a Model T.
Ford, right.
Yeah, and Ford very much wanted Carver to come to Detroit to work with him, and Carver said no. I mean, he didn't even want to take, he was offered $100,000. Think about it now. People were rich. People lived very well on $5 a day. And he was offered a check of $100,000 from Henry Ford. He told him, no, thank you. He's going to stay right there in Tuskegee. I mean, the man, you were right. You wouldn't call him an avatar. I called him a shaman, priest. He was very, very highly spiritually developed.
Right, and then the American government came to him for certain things that he studied from plants. And to this day, when you look at a car factory, you call it a car plant. You call it a plant. That's the plant,
Yes, sir.
And not only that, I mean, you also have Benjamin Banneker, who was also one of those quote-unquote avatars and geniuses, because he built the clock from wood, and also he was responsible for the building of the plans for the building of Washington, D.C. By memory now, because the France took their plans when they had a fallout with the American government, and this man had memorized the plans, and they built it from his memory. They were able to build it. Benjamin Banneker.
Yes, sir. And there are a lot of very great people who have made America, who have helped to build up America, who have not been acknowledged or recognized.
I mean, majority of the things that we weren't even taught this in school, but the majority of the inventions were created by African people that were enslaved or after Jim Crow. You can research that for yourself and see that. You'd be like, wow, I didn't know this. You don't know until you do your own research and your own, reading of different people in this country, of African people that did this. You'd be like, man, it's amazing when you find out about it, but thank you.
Well, we thank you for calling, and I'm very happy that you have done that research and choose to share it with the world. Peace be unto you.
Thank you so much for calling. Now, Rashid, you and I have had a discussion about some vitamins. What's your opinion of taking vitamins? You want to respond to that?
Yeah, look, if they're natural and soluble, I have no problem with that at all. I mean, people are eating bad food, so if you need some supplements to help you. As far as the fish is concerned, I wouldn't touch a farm-raised fish.
I know that's a concern.
Well, I saw a picture the other day. You know, the FDA is now allowing
GMO
salmon.
It's just outrageous.
And they showed a picture of the natural salmon was about a quarter of the size of a GMO salmon, and we're putting that stuff in our bodies.
It's just outrageous. I want to have a program on that as well, but thank you for joining us.
Well, I enjoy your show. It's just this thought that, you see, when society wants to change behavior for the better, like absentee belts or no smoking, they do a very successful campaign in that regard. So my question is, when you see a genius like George Washington Carver, other than in the context of Black History Month, why is there not a sustained effort to take it to the racist and say, look at this guy, this is a genius, and to rotate between George Washington Carver, Paul Robeson, or any number of the genius people of color, and use that as a leverage until you get the point across? Because what better illustration of insanity, of racism, other than to hold up an example of somebody who has had such a positive impact on millions of people's lives? What do you think of that idea?
Well, it's a great idea. The problem is, it's not in the economic interests of those who own and control the means of production, distribution, and exchange to extol the virtue of people who on whose backs the fortunes have been made, right? Because then if you raise that image too high, then you're going to get into the R word, reparations, which is going to be a subject that people are not going to be able to identify with. As I read history, I always say follow the money. And every great fortune in this country began with a great crime that was committed. And the biggest crime that this history has ever undergone was the stealing of Black people and putting them to work as slaves. There are three factors. And this is what I did my graduate work. It's part of what I did my graduate studies on. What are the factors of development? How do you build a country? You have to have land, labor, and capital are the three major factors that will determine the success. The reason that America is the richest country in the history of the world is because it had free labor, which is Black people, had free land because they committed genocide against the Native Americans, and the capital came from Europe. So when you read back on that history and look at it, these are the things that you see. So yeah, George Washington Carver was great. Paul Robeson, look what they did. They crushed that man. He was a writer, singer, athlete, a Rhodes Scholar. I mean, he was just such an intelligent man. Since you raised his name, they took away his passport, told him he couldn't talk to any people, and just grounded him, man, put him on house arrest. And this is what happens to the geniuses. They get their legs cut from out underneath them because they are telling a truth. They're speaking truth to the power, and that you get punished for that. And this is part of what happens. I'm sorry. Go ahead, sir.
No, I was just going to say, the other side of the coin, about not giving credit where credit's due, I happen to be an attorney, and I say to people, if you met a serial killer or somebody guilty of genocide, even if that person in his life or her life did one great thing, that does not overshadow the evil acts that person had done. So by the same token, I don't understand how people revere people, the signers of the Constitution, and hold this document up in such high regard when you have a Thomas Jefferson. To me, if you own slaves, you're guilty, you're a serial killer, or worse.
I'm going to ask you to hold that thought for just a moment. We're going to take a quick break, and we'll be back with you in just a moment, okay? Stay tuned.
Thank you.
Project South and the Hunger Coalition of Atlanta, in partnership with community organized relief effort, have launched free COVID-19 testing at 9 Gammon Street, Southeast Atlanta. Drive-through and walk-up testing options are available Monday through Friday from 10 a.m. to 4 p.m. The tests are self-administered via throat swab, and individuals will be contacted within 4 to 7 days with results. If you need COVID-19 testing, 404-622-0602. If you need testing for the coronavirus, this is your opportunity. Once again, That's 404-622-0602. Project South and the Hunger Coalition of Atlanta, in partnership with community organized relief effort, have launched COVID-19 testing at 9 Gammon Street, Southeast Atlanta. CoreResponse.org/COVID-19-Atlanta.
Another public service announcement by your listener-sponsored and supported community radio, 89.3 FM, WRFG.org.
Yes, again, my name is Heather Gray, and the program is Just Peace, and we're talking with Rashid Nuri. I think we still have our caller on the line, though. Caller, are you there?
Yes, but I mean, that was basically my thought, is I don't understand this fantasy that these slave owners should be held in high regard because they drafted this Constitution, which, you know, has its own issues.
But, yeah, really.
So I'm happy to see this movement, like in Princeton, where they're trying to rid the name of the hall that's named after Woodrow Wilson, who was a, you know, so-called racist. So I was just wondering what...
Thank you so much. We so appreciate your call and comments. Go ahead, Rashid.
Yeah, that Ivy League thing. You know, most of the presidents of the Ivy League, many of the presidents of the Ivy League schools owned slaves, and it was slaves used to make the beds of all the elite children that went to those schools. They were served in the dining rooms. So slavery is an integral part of the history of this country, and at every single level. The major corporations, particularly up there in the Northeast, all of them were in the shipping business, the insurance business, and all those businesses were built around the slave trade. That is the fundamental economic engine for the development of the United States, was slavery. And every other ethnic group in this country has received reparations except black people. Okay, and I think that's something that's will be addressed at some point in the future. I mean, you have these folk, Black Lives Matter, and the other organizations and movements that try. I mean, what's happened out there in Missouri? There are more and more people becoming. At University of Missouri, more and more people are becoming conscious of this historical imperative to have these issues resolved. It's going to take some time. You know, slavery, we are 100 years out, we're about 5 generations out of slavery now, but how many of the generations do we have during that 400 years? So to say we're 5 generations out and things haven't gotten right, I mean, black people just got voting, you know, in my lifetime, and now, you know, they're trying to, that attempts to roll that back. And,
absolutely.
You know, what's happening over in Alabama, where they're closing all the centers so people can get the ID card so they can go vote. I mean, so in a lot of ways, we are repealing the advances that black people have made in this country, and we have yet to address the 400 years of slavery that made this country what it is.
Yeah. Thank you for that, Rashid. I think we have another caller, do we, Sabukwe? Caller, are you there?
Yes, I am.
Thank you for joining us. You have a question or comment you'd like to make.
Yes, this is Kwesi Jumoka. How are you doing?
Ah, Kwesi. Wonderful to hear your voice. Thank you for calling in.
And how you doing, Brother Rashid?
Oh, you my brother. There ain't no doubt about that. I'm fine, Jumoka. Good to hear your voice.
It's interesting because I was listening to the show and listening to y'all talk about agriculture, trying to figure out how I was going to bring reparations in. And then I said, God is good. Rashid brought it in.
So a lot of interesting comments this evening, Rashid.
Yeah, we seem to go a lot of interesting places when you and I sit down here to chat, and it's a pleasure. I really enjoy this hour that we spend. It helps to stretch my mind and help me to learn, particularly when, you know, some of the questions that people ask connect dots. I'm able to connect those dots and just expands my own understandings.
Great. I think we're going to have another caller here. Yeah, you know, we're going into Thanksgiving now, okay, so you're going to have
right,
a lot of.
Quickly,
we have a caller.
A few minutes ago, okay?
Yeah.
All right, sir. Caller, are you there? Hello.
Hey, I'm here.
Oh, thank you for joining us. You have a question or comment you'd like to make?
Just a comment.
Okay.
Lately, I've been becoming conscious of this, you know, the way the world works and Black America and everything, and it took me a long time to find this station, and. I feel so good just listening to the consciousness And because I'm 25 years old, and I try my best as a barber when I have young black men sit down in my chair to try to educate them as much as I can about who we are, where we came from, really not what we were taught in that 12-year babysitting program. I'm talking about the real who we are, you know, and I just want to let y'all know I appreciate everything.
Thank you, brother. You know, I got a sign that's in front of me advertising 89.3 FM WRFG. Real music, real issues for real people. So we need to support our community.
Yes, well, listen, I'm wanting to thank you so much, and I'm glad it's been meaningful for you. We have another caller, so and keep listening.
Will do.
All right, take care now. Spook Boy, we have another caller. Caller, you there? We just have a few minutes left, but I'm glad you called.
I'd like to know, how is it that America is giving reparation to Jewish people for Holocaust, and we had nothing to do with the Holocaust, but yet won't give it to black people?
Good question.
Yeah, I raised that same.
That's a good question.
Every ethnic group, they're giving reparations to the Japanese, to the Germans, to the Native Americans, but not to black people, and because that would be an admission of guilt that this country is not prepared to deal with. I mean, that's the bottom line. Just follow the money. If they say that give reparations to black people for slavery, that's admitting that the whole notion of America is built on a false premise. And that's not correct. So I understand why. The question is, what's going to happen?
All right. Thank you so much for calling and making that statement.
Okay. All right.
So we have another caller. We're going to take, I guess, one more caller here.
We're going to try to put you in. Okay.
All right. So
go ahead.
Caller, you there?
No.
Hi. How are you?
It's the young lady.
Okay. Thank you so much for calling.
I don't have time for another.
Hi, I just wanted to speak on the reparations and just what I feel we need to do as black people. I'm 27 years old. I graduated from Clark Atlanta University. And I think we need to start building our own communities. Like, if you look at every other race of people that come here to the United States, they all build their own towns where they're employing each other and helping one another. We're always giving back to other communities. As black people, we don't have anything that we can call our own, you know, and I think if we start there and start showing the other black people, if we come together, we are so powerful because, we built this country,
even
though they don't want to give us credit.
Not at all. But I think if you go back, there have been a lot of great men and women who have has espoused that statement. Whether you go back, Noble Drew Ali, Father Divine, Dead Daddy Grace, my teacher, Honorable Elijah Muhammad, Louis Farrakhan, Waritha Dean Muhammad, all these folks and many more have talked about let's do for self. Booker T. Washington, that's what he talked about, trying to train black people to have the skills to be able to support ourselves. So I agree with you. We got to do for ourselves. And that's why I work so hard to teach people. First of all, if whoever controls your food controls you. So that's where I start with food. I want to teach people how to grow food, how to be self-dependent, self-sufficient, and I pray God will accept our work in moving in that direction to help to build this kind of self-dependency that you're describing.
Yes, but you know what? Can I say one more thing? I so agree with you. And we also, not only do we need to grow our own food, but we need to teach our own selves. We need to have our own schools, our own hospitals, because that's the only way. Everything that we built was everything was built on our backs, but everything was built for white people. You know, the school systems, everything. Nothing was for our own benefit. Like, they always talk about slavery, but no one ever goes beyond that. Who we were beyond that, we were kings and queens. We ruled in Europe and everything, but nobody, you know, we never go past that, past the slavery. I think if we
still
understand who we are, we got to know who we are in order to know where we're going.
Okay, we are kings and queens, and we need to carry ourselves with that dignity.
Exactly, exactly. I want to thank you so much for calling.
This is my first time listening, and I'm so grateful for you guys.
Oh, thank you so much. Thank you so much. So we look forward to hearing from you again sometime, okay?
Thank you so much.
All right, my pleasure. So I'm wanting to thank Rashid. Give some contact information, Rashid, before we go quickly.
My number is 404-520-8331.
Thanks, everyone.
We cannot lie our way to the truth. We cannot lie our way to the truth. We spin and spin the earth around. We cannot lie our way to the truth. lives.
Amen.
Lying will destroy us.
Amen.
Lying will destroy us.
Amen.
And truth will set us free.
Truth will set us free.
Spend our way out of debt. We cannot spend our way out of debt. We spin and spin the earth around. We cannot spend our way out of debt. Greed will destroy us.
Amen.
Greed will destroy us.
Speak the truth. Stand up.
Stand up.
And speak the truth.
And speak the truth.
We the people have the power to change all corruption. If we would only come together.
Come together.
And speak the truth.
And speak the truth.
Stand up.
Stand up.
Stand. speak the truth.
And speak the truth.
Put my life on the line.
I put my life on the line
to try to stop.
To try to stop
this awful crime.
This awful crime.
But we the people.
But we the people
have the power.
Have the power
to stop all.
Stop all
corruption.
Corruption.
If we would only.
If we would only
come together.
Come together
and speak the truth.
And speak the truth.
You can hear me saying,
yeah.
Stand up,
yeah.
Stand up,
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 and speak the truth,
and speak the truth.
Truth.
It's so easy, it's so easy, it's so easy,
and when you come together and speak the truth, you got to stand together and speak the truth. Let's get together,
let's get together,
let's get together,
oh yeah.